and this is Parag with B&WTek. Thank you for joining us for the sixth episode of our educational video series. Today we're going to be talking about Raman spectroscopy. So Parag, what is Raman spectroscopy?
Sure. So let's talk about Raman scattering or the Raman effect first. And this is nothing but the inelastic scattering of a photon off of molecules. The spectroscopic techniques used to then observe the different rotational, vibrational, or other low-frequency modes in a system is called Raman spectroscopy.
Okay, and what is Raman spectroscopy used for?
Well, primarily Raman spectroscopy is used for material ID. It's nothing but a molecular fingerprint. But it's also used commonly to measure crystallinity, stress strain, amongst other things.
Okay, now what do you mean by a molecular fingerprint?
Right, so let's take a molecule, for example, and let's say that this molecule has five or six different bonds, right? Now, what we're doing in Raman to observe Raman scattering or the Raman effect is we're shining a monochromatic light of a certain wavelength onto this molecule, and then through the backscatter, we're actually observing the wavelengths that come out. Now, the difference between these two is nothing but a Raman shift. So all of the four or five different bonds that you have in your molecule are going to give you a certain shift. And when we take the combined spectra, no two molecules are going to have the same spectra.
Okay. So could you walk me through taking a Raman measurement?
Sure. So there are three basic components to any Raman spectrometer system. The first one is your laser. In this case, we're using a B&WTek manufactured clean lase, which is our patented technology. Now, this gives you an extremely narrow line width and stability of the laser. Why the line width, the narrow line width is important is because the narrower your line width, the sharper and clearer your peaks that you're going to see in the results. And the more stable that your laser is, the less deviation you see in your measured spectrum. The second component is your probe, which actually consists of a fiber optic that guides the laser into the head over here. Mm-hmm. And this head comprises of a bandpass filter, which then goes into the shaft of the probe. And the second thing that the probe does is it also focuses the laser. Now, Raman being a really, really weak phenomenon, you need a very small, highly focused spot size to give you a good signal. The third thing that it does is it collects the backscatter, and then that passes through an edge filter, which then guides it through a fiber optic through to the spectrometer. Now, in this case, we're using an Exemplar Plus spectrometer, which is, again, the top-of-the-line spectrometer manufactured by B&WTek. This actually helps because the Raman being a very weak phenomena, the higher sensitivity of the back-thin, back-illuminated CCD is really necessary in this case.
Okay, so that sounds like a combination of a few of the other topics that we've discussed in this series.
Yeah, it's actually a combination of all five that we've spoken about in the past videos.
Okay, so could you explain how it involves some of those other techniques?
All right, let's start with absorption. So when we say, you know, you shine the laser onto your sample, what's actually happening is the molecules are absorbing the laser, the energy, and then getting excited to a virtual energy state. Now, when they relax back to a real energy state, they emit a photon of light similar to fluorescence.
Okay, so that covers absorption, emission, and fluorescence.
Yep.
So could you explain about reflection and transmission then?
Sure. So when we spoke in the reflection video, we spoke about the specular and diffused reflection. Mm-hmm. Now, we have two similar components in this case. We have the Rayleigh scattering, which is similar to your specular reflection, and you have the Raman scattering, which is similar to your diffused reflection.
Okay.
And in transmission, let's say you have a packaging material like this poly bag over here. Now, if this is actually thinner than that working distance that the probe focuses the laser on, and if it's transmissive at your excitation wavelength, then you could start measuring the compounds inside the packaging material without it being an interference.
Okay. So can we go ahead and take a Raman measurement of this Tylenol pill?
Sure. Why don't you place a Raman probe on top of the pill and then open the shutter?
Okay.
Now, if I just take a single acquisition, what you see here is the Raman spectra for acetaminophen, which is actually the active pharmaceutical ingredient inside that Tylenol pill.
Okay.
And one thing I do want to point out here, Stephanie, is that the x-axis is your Raman shift, which we measure in wave numbers as opposed to absolute wavelength in order to normalize the spectra so that they're independent of the excitation wavelength.
Okay. So as far as all these components, would they all be found inside this Raman system here?
Yeah, you would have similar components inside a Raman system.
Okay.
Now, the latest trend in Raman spectroscopy is actually these handheld analyzers, which are simple pass-fail machines, and they're extremely easy to operate for both the technical and the non-technical user.
Okay.
So, if I were to say it's for someone like you who is unfamiliar with this technology or this instrument, would you try to take a scan?
Sure.
So why don't we try the caffeine?
Okay.
All you have to do is put it in front of it, and you want to go in the investigation mode.
Okay.
And then it's as simple as hitting the laser button there.
Okay. And it says setting acquisition parameters, and then acquiring spectrum. So it tells you what it's doing
Absolutely.
The whole time.
Yeah, and it does all the dark compensation. It automatically integrates to a certain intensity,
okay,
which is required.
And it says match to the library, so it says caffeine.
Absolutely, yep.
That's cool. So what are some real-life applications, then, of Raman?
So like we just saw, we measured caffeine. So Raman spectrometers are used a lot in the pharma industry to measure to ID and verify the incoming raw materials. Now, some of the more research-based applications are in carbon nanotubes, or scientists use Raman spectroscopy to see whether graphene has been, you know, they do single atomic layers of graphene, and so they use Raman spectroscopy to detect that. Those are just some of the applications. It's also very heavily used in the plastics industry.
Okay. All right, great. Well, thank you so much for your time today, Prag. I hope you found this as educational as I did. Be sure to stay tuned for future educational videos. And as always, you can check www.bwtek.com to get more information, or call 1-855-MY-BWTek to speak with an application specialist like Prag. So thank you so much.
Thanks.